Please welcome Vice President Analytics, AWS, Rahul Pathak.
Hey, everybody. I'm Rahul Pathak, the VP for Analytics at AWS. It's just awesome to see all of you here, and thank you to everybody for making the trip out, and thank you, everyone, on the live stream for tuning in. So I love getting to build products that help our customers make sense of their data and get better insights to help drive their businesses, and I'm just really excited to be here today to share with you some of the work that our teams have been working on, and let's dive right in. So what we're really seeing across the board is that our customers are really reinventing their businesses with data. And data is really at the core of everything that they're trying to do to drive better decisions, to make better outcomes for their businesses, and to figure out how to better react to what's going on. And data is really driving everything that's happening in terms of innovation in our customer base, really across the board and across the world. And what we've seen is that, as we all know, data volumes have been exploding. There's been a dramatic increase. We've seen typically the data volumes grow up by a factor of about 10x every 5 years or so. And so what this means is that our customers that were dealing with gigabytes are now dealing with terabytes, and customers that were dealing with terabytes are dealing with petabytes, and we've got customers now that are in the high hundreds of petabytes and even pushing exabytes. So it's just a dramatic change in the type of data that customers are dealing with, and the variety of data that's being dealt with is also changing dramatically. And so what we're seeing is that it's really not just the classical structured data that was in tables or log data, but it's also about unstructured data, images, audio recordings, video recordings, and in fact, 80% of the data that's being generated today is actually unstructured. And so the challenge that our customers have is how to bring all of this together, acquire this data, collect it, and then make sense of it and use it to drive business value. And so what we've seen is that customers have taught us that they've been using data to survive, so to figure out how to adapt to what's been happening. You know, the pandemic has really taught us that no one really knows what's going to happen in the world and things can change quickly. And we've seen customers, for example, in the travel industry that had to scale down their business, and then when things opened up again, had to scale them up dramatically, so the need to be informed about what's going on in your environment and adapt has been critical. And then to thrive and to adapt and to be able to grow as things change, data's also been really driving and informing that. And the customers that have been able to modernize and adapt and make themselves ready to be agile are the ones that are really succeeding with all of this. And so it's really critical to be able to make data-driven decisions today. And it's really about the survival of the most informed. And while we can't predict the future, we do know that change is always going to be inevitable, and getting ourselves in a position to react to it is one of the best things we can do for our businesses. And so it's really about figuring out how to put data to work. And customers that are able to gather data about their businesses and their customers, they're able to make better decisions, they can figure out how to drive efficiency, they can respond faster to what's happening in the environment around them. And then it's about uncovering new opportunities and new ways of deepening your relationships with your customers, new ways of innovating on their behalf, and about looking around corners. And so just to give you a few examples of this, let's talk about FINRA. So FINRA regulates U.S. equities. 98 to 99% of all U.S. equities go through FINRA. They actually ingest 250 billion records per day using Amazon EMR, which is our open source analytics service. They can handle up to 20 terabytes of data per day, and they're finished 90% of their jobs in under a minute. And they use a range of services to do this. They launch thousands of EMR nodes in their environment to process this data. They're able to use Spot, which is our dynamic pricing capability on EC2, to drive down their costs by 60 to 70%. And they're using a broad range of services to actually enable this data to take place. And FINRA is really responsible for making sure the markets are well run, there's no bad actors, there's no insider trading, so it's a critically important function for the US markets and the economy. Another example I'm sure many of you are familiar with is Pinterest. So Pinterest is one of the largest visual discovery engines in the world, and they've got over 400 million monthly active users. That's an amazing number of people getting on Pinterest to really discover their visual tastes. And they move their analytics to Amazon Open Search Service. And this allows them to use their log analytics in real time. And they're able to actually reduce their operational burden. They're able to drive down the cost of their processing. And they're able to scale up their log search and analytics from 500 gigabytes to 1.7 terabytes of data. And to reduce their costs by 30 to 50%. So it's a dramatic savings and a dramatic increase in capability. And they're using, again, a range of services in our analytics portfolio in addition to Open Search Service, as well as S3 at the core for their data lakes. And then NASDAQ is another great customer of ours. You probably heard from them in Adam's keynote, but they're similarly one of the largest exchanges in the world, and they power exchanges with their software for other providers as well. And they're doing 30 to 70 billion records at peak. And then during COVID, they were well over the 100 billion record mark. And for them as well, they're really able to get the insights faster. They're saving up to 5 hours on their processing. And I actually began working with NASDAQ, I think it was in the summer of 2012, when we were first working on Amazon Redshift. And so it's been amazing to have this journey with them. And they actually combine data in open formats in data lakes, which gives them a ton of flexibility. And they query that using Amazon Redshift, which is our data warehousing service for best possible performance. So again, you can see this common theme of the ability to respond to changing environments using the services that we offer at AWS. And really what we're trying to do for our customers and for all of you is to give you the ability to deal with data from end to end, from ingestion to storing data in databases and data lakes in services that are really optimized for those use cases. Then it's about figuring out how to analyze and visualize that data so that you can get value from it. And then finally, it's about putting it to work using machine learning and thinking about how you can build predictive applications so you can anticipate the needs of your customers and really change their lives for the better by what you're able to do for them. And all the while, you want to be able to do this while you're providing good security and good governance and access control. You know, customers sometimes think that access control and governance is in conflict with velocity. It's not true. If you actually have good guardrails and protection on your data, you're able to set it free and allow people to experiment and iterate because you're confident that your data is well protected and only the right people have access to it. And really, I want to tell you about all of the capabilities that we offer to customers to make this possible. And so when we think about customers that are really trying to reinvent and transform themselves with data, we're really helping them in a number of areas. So the first is around modernization. So customers are looking to modernize their infrastructure with the most scalable and trusted and secure cloud provider. They're looking to break free from legacy old guard systems, which are expensive and that can be tricky to scale and typically don't deal with the new wave of data that customers need to process. And then customers are also looking to unify data. Typically, data has existed in a number of different places in the organization. You can have silos. And often, you're trying to build a complete picture of the data that you have. And customers are trying to bring that data together, connect it across these various silos, bring relevant pieces into data lakes and into purpose-built systems so they can start to build holistic pictures of their business. And then finally, it's about innovation. How can you find new opportunities for savings, new opportunities to innovate or to personalize? And this is really about the continuum of data and in bringing that into machine learning and predictive analytics. So you know, let's dig into what modernize really means. And in this session, I'm really going to focus on modernizing and unification. Innovate's going to be covered in a bunch of different sessions across the board. So when we're diving into modernize, it's really about moving from on-premise and self-managed data stores into managed services so that customers no longer have to deal with the muck of keeping systems up and running, of provisioning them and scaling them and backing them up. We're really trying to take care of this on behalf of our customers so they and you can all focus on the things that really drive value and differentiate your business. And so it's really about moving from these legacy systems into more modern cloud-native systems that are managed and often serverless so that customers can really take advantage of all of the innovation that we're working on and work on delivering business results more quickly. So if you look at a modern cloud-based application, you know, historically, you might have had a system that was relying on one database, had one application server. But now a modern app will typically have different sections of the application using different systems optimized for the particular workload at hand. And so you might have for the search bar something with a search index. Your shopping cart might be a relational database so you can process transactions. Your customer reviews could be in a key value system. And then a recommendation engine that's providing you suggestions on what to buy next could be using a graph database, which is all about finding the connections between what people buy and what similar people do. And it's really about decomposing applications into smaller services. We've seen this trend with application development as we've went from monolith to client server to microservices. And similarly, we're seeing this in data and analytics, where customers have gone from monolithic single systems into using the right tool for the right job. And we think this is really critical and the correct way to build modern applications. And so in this world, the traditional model of databases feeding a data mart or a data warehouse that fed reports, and these things existing in multiple silos in the organization, this starts to break down when you're dealing with modern applications and the modern volumes and variety of data that customers are dealing with. And we're looking at data from everything from these classic databases and enterprise ERP systems, as well as event data like log files, things like clickstream, and then you've got telemetry from machine-generated data like IoT devices. And all of this needs to be brought together to build holistic pictures of what's going on. And so what we're seeing now is customers are moving to a world where they're really using the best of purpose-built data stores, data lakes, they're using analytics services that are fit for purpose, and they're combining this with machine learning. And really, this is a continuum. Data moves around the cycle to where it can be best ingested and analyzed and used to build applications. And this is all underpinned with integrated catalogs, so you know where your data is, and integrated governance, so you can set up these guardrails and access controls and data protection, and then set people free to innovate using that data. And you know, when it comes to putting data to work, unification is about bringing things together, about getting the best of breed from data lakes and purpose-built data stores so you have a complete and coherent picture of what's going on. And you want to be able to connect all of your data together. So you want to know what's in your databases, what's in your data warehouse, and what's in your data lakes. And you want to be able to integrate, query that data together, move it around if needed. And this is how you build those full pictures of what's happening in the environment. And so with customers, you know, they've got a multitude of data sources. Data typically will be generated. They might stream into a data lake. They might go into a database. This data can then end up in an analytics system where you'll be running queries and reports. That data can then be used to drive machine learning applications. And those models can then be used to personalize the experiences that people have when they interact with your applications or your business. And then customers are trying to build this feedback loop. So once you have a prediction about, say, how someone's going to react to a piece of content, you display it to them, they then take an action, they either read it or they don't, and you record what happens, and that becomes signal that feeds back into your ingestion systems and can be used to retain and retrain and refine your models. So you build this virtuous loop of what's happening with data. And when it comes to thinking about a modern data strategy on AWS, it's really about bringing together the best of breed of purpose-built databases. So these are systems that are designed for particular use cases. So you have things like Amazon DynamoDB for key value use cases, Aurora for relational systems, DocumentDB for document-oriented workloads, and so on. You've got purpose-built analytics services like Amazon Redshift for data warehousing, Amazon EMR for open source analytics. You've got a data lake at the core, and then you've got a service like AWS LakeFormation for easy setup and governance on your data lake, and then services like Glue for data transformation and data integration, and Athena for serverless querying of all of your data from a single place. And so I'll talk about more of these as we go, but it's really about being able to take advantage of each of these pieces for the entire lifecycle of data. And as Adam mentioned in his keynote, you really need all of these pieces to really make to get the most value out of what's happening in your environment. And so our aim is to provide you with easy abstractions and managed services to make sure they all work well together so that you can really handle and adapt to any use case that you have. And these systems are modular. You don't have to adopt them all in one go. You can start wherever you need to start and then add them as needed. And also use systems like Amazon SageMaker for machine learning that ties all of that together for predictive applications. A good example of this is a company called Engie. So they're a global energy company based in Europe. They supply and help millions of customers with maximizing the amount of renewable energy that they use. And so they've accumulated a massive amount of data from the diverse set of projects that they operate. They've got 200 terabytes in their data lake that they bring together. And then they use it to do analytics and drive automated energy predictions. And all of this is aimed at driving up the adoption and consumption of renewable energy, which is really about sustainability in the long run. And it's great to be able to support them in their mission to help their customers use energy more responsibly. So when it comes to thinking about a modern data strategy on AWS, there's really five key pillars. There's data lakes. You want to use purpose-built systems to really get the best possible performance at the lowest possible cost. And that's important because as your data volumes go up, you want to be able to analyze it, but you don't want your costs to increase at the same rate. You want to get more value there. We want to make sure these systems are easy to use, and being serverless is a big part of this. And I'll talk more about that as we go. And then the unified data access and governance and security is a critical foundational piece. And then finally, you want machine learning to be pervasive. The growth in that is just huge, and it's really unlocking a ton of new potential for our customers. So let's dive into data lakes. So with data lakes, you can move any amount of data into silos. And on AWS, this is typically an Amazon S3 data lake. It allows you to keep data in open formats. Those are industry standard. It lets you avoid lock-in. Also allows you to take advantage of the best of breed in technology. And all of our services are engineered to work with these open formats, so you always have the flexibility to evolve your analytics as new technology becomes available and as you discover new use cases. And S3 has been the most popular choice for data lakes because it's unmatched in terms of scalability, reliability, performance, and durability. And it's really been a key foundational service. It's one of the earliest services that we launched and is really the backbone of a modern data strategy on AWS. And with S3, customers have all of these capabilities, and they're able to act and use multiple workloads simultaneously on all of this data. And this is a real game changer for customers. And so we talked about the FINRA example. FINRA began on-premise using a legacy appliance. They moved to an open format on S3. And for you data geeks out there, they started off with Hive on MapReduce. They moved to Hive on Tez, which was a faster way to run Hive, which is a big data analytics workload. They were then able to adopt Presto and then Spark, all without having to re-platform, because their data was in an open format. They could bring up new systems and new technologies, and so they effectively future-proofed themselves. And they're well set up for anything new that comes along when there's a new technology a year from now that represents yet another step forward. And this is the model that really S3 enables for customers. And when it comes to data lakes, you can really store all of the data that you have. S3 scales practically without limit, and so customers can go from just getting started all the way up into exabytes. And that decoupling of storage and compute gives you choices. And then finally, you're able to process data in place. You don't have to move it if you don't want to. Sometimes you do for performance or for specific workloads. But in general, you can just use it in place with whatever system that you need for analytics or ML. And then some of our customers have multiple data lakes in their organizations. And many of you may have read about data mesh architectures. And this is a model where you have multiple teams that own their own data and essentially vend it to other teams in the organization or share it externally. And so you might have a data lake in your marketing organization. You might have a data lake in your operations and support organization. And a data mesh approach on S3 and using the services that we talked about allows you to essentially have each team own their data and then provide it through a well-controlled set of APIs to other teams, and to share it and to collaborate to enable you to build kind of scalable architectures around data that let you take advantage of data across the organization. And again, S3 is a key enabler for building data lake and data mesh architectures. And there's more data lakes and data meshes and analytics on AWS than anywhere else. And we've got hundreds of thousands of customers running data lakes on AWS. And this ranges from companies like Vanguard or BMW and GE Healthcare, Zillow, Slack, and more. It's really pervasive, and it's been a game changer for customers when it comes to analytics at scale. And so to leverage this modern data architecture, customers are using purpose-built data stores, and these are really built to deliver performance and scale, and really, at the end, unmatched value to help you all make the most of the data that you're generating and drive insights faster. And so let's talk about purpose-built data stores. So we provide the broadest and deepest set of purpose-built data services optimized to give you the best-in-class functionality for your use cases. And as I mentioned, we do think that having the right tool for the right job is the right way to think about your data applications, because then you can make sure you're not compromising on performance or functionality or scale. When you try and use one tool to do everything, you're inevitably going to run into compromises or run into limitations that prevent you from being able to scale the way you want to scale. And that's really why we focus on purpose-built systems. And so with Redshift, this is one of the services that I was lucky enough to work on as the first product manager back in 2012 when we launched it at the first Reinvent 10 years ago. And this is where you get super fast queries on structured data. It also integrates with data lakes and operational data stores. And when we launched it, it really disrupted the economics for data warehousing in the cloud. We made Redshift available at a tenth the cost of better of legacy systems, and it really unlocked a huge wave of innovation for customers. With Athena, this is a serverless service that enables you to run SQL directly on all of your data from a single place. And this allows you to query vast amounts of structured and unstructured data sitting in your data lakes. With Amazon EMR, if you want to process huge amounts of unstructured data using dynamically scaling clusters and the latest in open source technology, you can use where things like Spark or Presto, you can use EMR. And EMR works directly against data in your S3 data lake, so you don't have to load it into local clusters. You can stream it directly. And then if you've got a large amount of log data that you want to analyze in real time or data that you want to search, we've got Amazon Open Search Service, which is the successor to the Amazon Elasticsearch Service. And this is a fully managed service for querying petabytes of data in near real time. And then if you want to process streaming data in real time, we've got Amazon Kinesis, which allows you to stream arbitrary amounts of data and run analytics on it in real time or route it to different analytics services for further analysis. And we've also got Amazon MSK, or Managed Streaming for Kafka. And this allows you to use the popular Apache Kafka framework for dealing with your streaming data and analytics. So really, for whatever workload you have, we want to provide you with a service that's aimed at doing that workload as efficiently as possible, so you can really meet any workload that you need. So let's dive into these briefly. So with Redshift, really one of the things that Redshift allows you to do is it really enables you to process all of your data at scale with very high performance. And so Redshift gives you the ability to query data that's in Redshift itself. That data is managed on S3. It lets you query data in open formats on your data lakes. It also lets you query data that's sitting in operational databases like Aurora or RDS. And you can query it all from one place using a familiar SQL interface. Redshift offers the best price performance that's available in the segment, with up to 3x better price performance than other data warehouse providers. And we'll continue to innovate here. And as you heard in Adam and Swami's keynotes, we're always innovating in Redshift to make it easier to use. And you can now query data, petabytes of data in your cluster, and combine that with potentially exabytes of data in S3 and query that efficiently. And it's been a real game changer for our customers, and it enables easy analytics for everybody. And so customers across the board are benefiting from Redshift. So Zynga is getting twice the ETL performance than they were able to get from their old systems. They're able to process over 5 terabytes of in-game data a day to see what players are doing and to really optimize the game experience for their customers. With Schneider Electric, they're able to use Redshift to support over 10,000 data users, and they're sharing data throughout the organization, using it to drive efficiencies and to look for opportunities for their customers to use energy more sustainably. Magellan RX has reduced their costs of running ML predictions in Redshift by 20%. And they're using Redshift's ability to integrate with Amazon SageMaker to run machine learning directly in Redshift. JobCase is matching millions of job seekers with jobs, and they're also be able to use Redshift machine learning to optimize these matches. And so they're looking at potentially billions of job searches and able to make recommendations in 15 to 20 minutes. And that's down from 2 to 3 hours. So just a huge win in terms of efficiency and no increase in costs. So just huge savings there and increase in capability. And then NASDAQ is another one that we talked about. So when it comes to performance, Redshift offers up to 3x better price performance than what's available from others. And this is really a testament to the hard work that the Redshift team has put into really engineering Redshift, starting with our RA3 instances, which uses data on S3. It separates storage and compute, but caches data locally on very fast SSD drives, so you get the best of both worlds in terms of scalability, but very high performance. And we've really been able to innovate in performance at each layer of the stack in Redshift so that we can deliver really high performance as your data volumes grow. And when it comes to Redshift, we really wanted to focus on making it easy to analyze all of your data. So Redshift has federated queries that connect into operational data stores. It's able to query data in your data lake directly. It works with industry standard BI tools like QuickSight and Tableau and others. It's also seamlessly integrated with services like SageMaker and ML for machine learning, training, and predictions. And then we also integrate with the AWS Data Exchange, where you can license third-party data sets as well as monetize your own data and have that seamlessly be shared into Redshift clusters. So really want Redshift to be at the hub of customer analytic workloads. And you know, when it comes to data sharing, you can share data in Redshift across clusters, across accounts, and even across regions. And this data sharing means that you can have different teams operating on different workloads independently of each other with the same view of the data that's always up to date. And with the AWS Data Exchange integration, you can now find and subscribe to third-party data sets and let AWS handle all of the contracting and licensing for you. And really, this is how we're putting data, helping deliver services that put data to work so that you can focus on what's really differentiating for your businesses. So let's look at a short video around this.
Redshift makes sharing and collaborating on data easier than ever before. With Amazon Redshift, you can share and query live data across organizations, accounts, and even regions. Integrate marketing data with the sales pipeline and partner leads to respond to customers faster. AWS Data Exchange for Amazon Redshift lets you find and subscribe to third-party datasets that you can query, analyze, and build applications on within minutes. As a data provider, you can make your data in Amazon Redshift or Amazon S3 available to others through AWS Data Exchange. And AWS automatically handles billing and payments for you. Amazon Redshift Query Editor V2 allows developers and analysts to run queries across your data warehouse, visualize them, and share across regions through a common interface. The free serverless web interface lets you access shared query tools and visualize results as your models run. Amazon Redshift Cloud Data Warehousing accelerates your time to insights with fast, easy, and secure analytics at scale.
And you know, really with Redshift, as we've talked about, it's about bringing this scale, really using it to empower all of your analytics, whether that's in central IT or across lines of business, and really empowering developers and analysts to make the most of their data. And I'm going to talk about how we're enabling this with Redshift Serverless a little later on in this session. And as you can see, I won't spend a ton of time on this, but we've really been innovating across the board in Redshift to make it easy for anyone to analyze all of their data. And this is with new query editors, new capabilities, things like materialized views where we can automate what customers are doing in terms of interactive queries and speed them up. We've been working on connecting all data, so enabling data sharing, things like ADX. And then enabling performance at scale. So RA3 nodes, things like Aqua, where we're using custom hardware and FPGAs to speed up scan-heavy queries. And then looking at things like concurrency scaling for reads and writes so that we can continue to perform as workloads go up and down. And a ton of innovation from the team, I think really all aimed at making Redshift work better for all of you. So now let's talk a little bit about Athena. So this is our serverless service, lets you query all of your data without managing any infrastructure. It's open, you can use standard SQL, ANSI SQL, and you can query just about any format of data, just about any database, and really query any type of system. And we have customers using Athena to query data in S3, data in DynamoDB, data from Salesforce, data from on-premise systems, and really combine them using a single familiar SQL interface. Athena's fast. It's really designed to deliver interactive performance regardless of scale. And then it's very cost-effective. You only pay for what you use. One of the core benefits of serverless, you just pay for the queries you run and the data that you scan. And typically, customers are able to save up to 30 to 90% by compressing or partitioning their data, and the system is efficient about automatically querying as little data as possible to answer the question that's being asked. And so there's no setup involved. You can simply go to a web console, type in a query, and start using it. And really, Athena's aimed at making it as easy as possible for you to get value from your data. And so it can be as simple as just putting your data in S3, pointing Athena to it and running SQL and getting those results back. And out of the box, Athena is compatible with the AWS Glue Data Catalog, which can automatically discover and catalog your data. Or you can also use an existing data catalog that you might have, like a Hive Metastore, and have that connect in and use that automatically. And you know, we've been hard at work in the Athena team to really improve the performance of the system. We've seen over a 3x performance over the past year, 3x performance gain, and we've been focusing on improving join performance, really trying to drive up the performance of individual functions and using a variety of advanced database techniques in order to be able to deliver this to you. And you know, there's no extra charge for any of this. The system just gets better as we iterate. And what this means for our customers is that they end up spending less and their queries speed up. And so you get this you know, for all of your workloads, and the team's continuously innovating here. And we've done things like added cost-based optimization, where we can run more efficient query plans, we can dynamically filter, skip partitions, and really work to get you answers as quickly as possible. And one of the things that customers have been really asking us for is that you know, they really like using S3 data lakes, but they've wanted to be able to do things like transactions and inserts and updates and deletes on their data lakes. And so I'm really excited to announce the preview of Athena's integration with Apache Iceberg. And Apache Iceberg is an open source format that enables customers to have these ACID transactions on data lakes. And with Athena's integration with it, you can now do these inserts and updates and deletes, as well as queries like time travel. So you can go back in time and see what happened and what data looked like. And that's really important in industries like financial services, where you might get asked a month from now to talk about a report that was generated a few days ago. And you can easily go back in time with these queries. And so I'd like to invite Janae to come on stage and give you a demo of Athena time travel.
In the past few years, Athena has focused on creating a seamless experience for its customers to query and analyze data within data lakes. Athena is now embarking on a journey to enable record and schema modification in order to support a larger set of your business and analytics needs. We selected Iceberg, an open table format for very large data sets, as one solution for us to enable write support. Iceberg is beneficial in several aspects because of its support for a variety of open file formats and optimized cloud object store interactions. It also has support for querying older snapshots of data, which is important for use cases like data usage analysis over time and financial audit. Iceberg also supports schema evolution, such as add column, drop column, as well as rename, reorder, and update column. I want to also mention compaction, which can significantly improve table read performance by reducing the amount of data of files read. The Athena team is developing features around table optimization, which are operations that do not change table data or update any user-facing metadata, but changes the table's underlying file contents or layout structure to improve table read performance. Now, let's take a look at some of the features that Athena brings with Iceberg integration as of Reinvent 2021. I will demo momentarily some of these features here, including our support for transactional writes using inserts, row-level updates and deletes, time travel, and some DDL operations like create table. Obviously, we will also do some reading of data. We are also launching new features around schema evolution, compaction, and Iceberg support for other DDLs like alter and drop table. Now, let's start off the demo by creating a simple Iceberg table. Note that you specify Iceberg as the table type in table properties in the create table statement. For this demo, we will be creating a table that stores customer information for a new online store. This store is not real, and the data for this table is mock data. Let's say that for our business use cases, they involve giving perks to our preferred customers. Since I'll be doing a lot of processing on data and customers who are preferred, I want to partition my data on that column. To do this, we include the preferred customer flag in the partition by clause in this create table statement. Next, we are going to perform a transactional write to populate this table from data in another table. Here is the insert statement, a transactional write operation for adding some 500 customers from that other table. This can take a while to run, so we have fast-forwarded it for you. Let's see what the data looks like in our Iceberg table now. This is a simple select statement to fetch data from the customer table. We're just ordering the results by the first name and limiting the results to 20. Next, let's say that we have a promotion for a subset of our customers named Aaron. During the month of December, we want to make sure these particular customers are happy. So we will make them preferred customers so they can take advantage of all our preferred customer perks. First, really quickly, let's use a select count statement to see how many Aarons are in our customer table. We can see from the result that there are 371. Altering the query a bit, I can see that of these 371 Aarons, 172 are preferred customers today. And so, now we can use an update statement, one of our new ACID operations supported with Iceberg, to update these records so that all Aarons are now preferred customers. With the update complete, let's do a simple read to see how many preferred Aarons are present in our table now. There are now 371 preferred customers with the first name of Aaron. Hence, our update operation was successful. In our next business use case, let's say we are pulling our stores from particular countries where our returns aren't what we expected. In our first round of removals, we want to remove customers who were born in Iceland from our table. For that, I'll perform a delete operation to remove all the records where the birth country is Iceland. But first, let's see how many there are in our table currently. When we run the select statement, we can see that there are 3. Now, let's execute the delete. And here, the delete is completed. We can perform a select statement from the table to see that there are no more records where the birth country is equal to Iceland. 0 is returned as the result, and hence, we'll be able to see that the delete is successful. Let's observe time travel in effect now. We just saw that there are no longer any Icelandic customers in the table. Let's say for some auditing reasons, we need to determine the changes in the number of customers over time. We can use the system time as of timestamp clause in our select statement to go back in time and see that we have 3 customers who are Icelandic. This is our time travel query where we can view data that was previously deleted. We can also observe a difference in trends in the number of preferred customers since we had performed an update there. These are the number of preferred customers now, 435. And let's run a time travel query to see how many preferred customers we had before we updated all those records with Aaron as the first name. This time travel query shows that before we performed the update statement, there were 239 preferred customers, different from the 435 that we currently have. Now, as a final exercise, let's do a comparison between the table that we have now and the table that we had previously at a specified time. When we run this query, we can see that we have 201 records that are different between now and the time specified in our query. The records with Iceland are here, and so are the records with first name Aaron, since those are the ones modified between the specified time and now. That's all for our demo on Athena Iceberg transactions. These features are now available in our latest Athena release, and we hope that you continue to enjoy our growing Athena functionality. Back to you, Rahul.
Thank you, Janae. Janae, thanks a ton. And that may have looked like a straightforward demo, but I think what Janae just demonstrated was just really cool. The ability to go back in time on data in S3 and have those transactions is a real game changer for customers. And so now let's talk about Amazon EMR. So EMR lets you easily run the latest in open source analytics frameworks, things like Spark and Hadoop and Hive and Presto. We automate the provisioning and the configuration of clusters. You get the latest of what's available. You actually get the ability to customize exactly what runs on the cluster. EMR is designed to automatically scale up and down. We actually began and launched EMR in 2009, and we had decoupled storage and compute back then. We're one of the first providers to have data on S3 and compute running in the clusters completely separated. And for those of you that are Hadoop geeks, at the time, data locality was a big thing, but we actually proved that with throughput on S3, you can actually get much better performance and much more flexibility operating in that way. And with EMR, like with our other services, we've really focused on driving the best possible price performance for all of you. And EMR works seamlessly with things like EC2 savings plans and EC2 spot, where you can get up to 80% discount on demand prices to make the most of what's available to you out there. And the real goal is to let you get your data processing done at as low cost as possible to open up more use cases. So let's talk about some of the innovations that we've been working on in EMR. So as I mentioned, we launched it in 2009. We've been adding capabilities around price, performance, functionality, but also we've done things for ease of use. So we've got EMR Studio, which gives you a Jupyter notebook environment for working with data interactively. We've got multiple deployment models. You can run EMR on EC2 instances or on EKS, which is our managed Kubernetes service. And then, as you heard earlier at reInvent, we've now got EMR serverless in preview, which we're super excited about, and I'll talk more about that later. And it also seamlessly integrates with data lakes and with lake formation. And when it comes to performance, really we've been working hard with EMR to give you the best possible performance out there. So the EMR Spark runtime is up to 2x faster than vanilla open source Apache Spark. This is based on the TPCDS 3 TB benchmark. We're up to 2.6x faster than Presto, which is an interactive SQL engine. You can get an 11% performance gain just by moving to Graviton 2. And then as you heard earlier, we have the Graviton 3 chips coming, and we're excited to see what we can drive there. And then not only do you get a performance boost for free, you actually get it for less. You now get it for up to 20% lower cost. So Graviton 2 is a big win, and we're excited about Graviton 3 as well. And you don't have to change your jobs. We're 100% compatible with the open source API, so it's just a drop-in replacement, and things get faster and things get cheaper. And that's the way it really should be for customers. And similar to the work we've been doing in Athena around performance, using a bunch of state-of-the-art query processing techniques, really making changes deep in the engine and around how query plans get executed so that customers get the benefit of all the innovation from the team without having to do any work or having to modify any jobs. And with EMR Studio, you're getting serverless Jupyter notebooks. You can collaborate, you can develop your jobs, you can debug them, and then you can start to build pipelines, and these notebooks can be used as part of scheduled jobs. So you get the ability to work interactively with your clusters in environments that are familiar and popular. And then, you know, let's talk about the Amazon Open Search Service. So this is the successor to the Amazon Elasticsearch Service. This is a fully managed service for working with Open Search and for Open Search dashboards. This is really aimed at making it easy to do log and search analytics at scale. And we've designed the service to be completely compatible with Elasticsearch, so it's the familiar, popular APIs. And then we've looked at ways to really drive price performance as usual. And so we've looked at ways to speed up queries. We've also got capabilities like Ultra Warm, which is the ability to tier your data into colder storage so you can save up to 60 to 70%, but still have that data available for querying. And we've got capabilities like AutoTune, which allows you to automatically modify your cluster parameters to optimize for the work that it's seeing, whether that's ingestion or query processing, all aimed at making it easier for you to maximize the value that you're getting from these services. And you know, the service is it's fully managed, and it's designed to let you deploy multiple versions of Elasticsearch and OpenSearch, but not have to deal with managing clusters. And then we've got built-in machine learning and anomaly detection, so you can get really advanced analytics available to you in real time. And we really build on the OpenSearch project. So this is an Apache 2.0 licensed version of Elasticsearch. And really, this is our commitment to make sure our customers always have a 100% open source version of Elasticsearch. And so we have the open distro that we launched in March of 2019. And then in earlier this year, we made available OpenSearch. And that's where we have an Apache 2.0 licensed version of the engine, as well as OpenSearch dashboards, which is an Apache licensed version of Kibana. And this is available. It's completely community-driven, and we're advancing this with the community for anyone to use and modify as they see fit. It's enterprise-grade, so a lot of our advanced functionality around security, SQL processing, machine learning, nearest neighbor detection, all of that's in here and available for free. And it's completely community-driven. We welcome contributions. The roadmap is in public. It's available. And you know, we look forward to collaborating with our partners and customers on this going forward. And now let's talk about streaming. So real-time data has been growing. As you can imagine, customers are looking to make faster decisions. And we have a number of capabilities in this area. We've got Kinesis data streams. We have Kinesis data analytics, which allows you to use real-time data and frameworks like Apache Flink for real-time analytics. We've got Kinesis video streams, which allows you to stream video in real-time and use that to make decisions. And then we've got the Kinesis data firehose, and this is really about making it drop-dead simple to get streaming data into an S3 data lake, pre-partitioned and optimized, ready for querying, or get it into a Redshift table, or into a system like Splunk or your search cluster of choice. And so really, regardless of your level of expertise or desire of what you'd like to do, we've got a managed service for you on the streaming front. And then similarly, for customers that want to use Apache Kafka, we've got Amazon MSK, which is managed streaming for Kafka, so fully compatible with Apache Kafka, a managed service. It's highly available, it's secure, and then we also made the serverless, and I'll talk more about that in a minute. But really, it's about ease of use and simplification for Kafka workloads at scale. And you know, more and more customers are using purpose-built analytics. It's really the right way for customers to build analytic workloads. And it's really all sizes, all industries, and it's about making available the technology that the largest companies can use to anyone and any developer anywhere in the world. So let's talk about serverless. You know, this is it's a big deal for customers. It's really keeping with our theme of taking work away from all of you so you can focus on things that differentiate your business. And so, you know, as Adam mentioned, we're really offering serverless capabilities for all of our major analytics services, so Redshift, EMR, Kinesis with on-demand that began serverless, and then you've got MSK, so now you can run serverless Kafka. And so what this means for our customers is you don't have to think about capacity, about provisioning and configuring clusters. You actually can save money if your workloads vary because the systems will automatically scale up and down. And it just sets you free to innovate and to think about your data and what you can do with it. And you don't have to have teams managing these systems. And so it's just a huge advance for our customers, and it represents a bunch of work on our end so that you can do less work on yours. And that's really the way we like it. And so with Redshift, you know, you get the best-in-class SQL performance in the industry now without having to manage any clusters. And again, this is about us doing work so you don't have to. Similarly, with EMR serverless, you can now get the latest in open source, but really just have to specify your minimum and maximum values of compute that you'd like to see, and then we'll automatically scale up and down. All you're doing is submitting work, and it's submitting it to the same open source APIs that you were doing before, just now no longer have to manage clusters. The core value that we've talked about, all of the benefits of the EMR service and runtimes with no infrastructure that you have to take care of. And here's a short
Companies
video on EMR
Companies are putting more
service.
Data into their data lakes and are using open source big data frameworks such as Apache Spark, Presto, Hive, and Flink to process this data. That's why we built Amazon EMR, a managed service that makes it easy to run petabyte scale data analytics in the cloud. With EMR, customers can provision clusters of any size in minutes. EMR automatically installs and configures open source frameworks and provides a performance optimized runtime that is compatible with and over 2 times faster than standard open source. EMR customers have full control over the configuration of their clusters and can optimize them for performance and cost based on their workload requirements. Tuning clusters for optimal cost and performance requires engineers to have deep knowledge of the underlying analytics frameworks. However, some customers don't need this level of customization and control and want a simpler way to run open source frameworks on EMR. Introducing Amazon EMR Serverless, a new deployment option in EMR that makes it easy and cost-effective to run applications built using open source frameworks such as Apache Spark, Hive, and Presto without having to tune, operate, secure, optimize, and manage clusters. Using EMR Serverless is super easy. Customers simply pick the open source framework to use and run their applications using APIs, CLIs, AWS Management Console, or with EMR Studio. EMR Serverless automatically provisions and scales the compute and memory resources required by applications, and customers only pay for the resources they use. With EMR Serverless, customers do not have to worry about over or under provisioning resources for their data processing jobs. Customers can check the status of running jobs in EMR Studio or the AWS console, review job history, and use familiar open source tools to debug jobs. EMR Serverless is the simplest way for customers to run applications built using open source big data analytics frameworks in the cloud. Try EMR Serverless today.
And then, as we mentioned with MSK, you get all of the benefits of Apache Kafka in a serverless model. So again, nothing to manage, scales up and down as you need it, and get the ability to use Kafka with all of your workloads. And again, we're really trying to make high availability, scalability, all of this seamless for you. And when we set out to make streaming serverless, it wasn't just about Kafka. We also wanted to make Kinesis on demand, so now you don't have to provision or think about capacity, just start using the service, and we will scale up and down virtually instantaneously as your workloads fluctuate. And again, you can see the similar theme of benefits as we go in all of these areas. Ease of use, less work on your end, and more work on ours, which is what we like. And so with all of these releases, we now offer the most serverless options for data and analytics in the cloud of any provider out there. And so whether that's Glue for ETL or lake formation for access control and setting up data lakes, and now with the 4 recent launches, really it's about simplifying analytics at scale so that you can get your work done faster and drive new innovation on behalf of your businesses for your end customers. Now, when it comes to unified data access, security, and governance, again, this is a critical enabler of velocity. You want to be able to automatically discover, catalog, and tag data, and then set up fine-grained permissions. And so for us, permissions and governance starts with lake formation, which is the easiest way to think about securing and governing S3 data lakes. And so what it allows you to do is to set up data lakes quickly. It can connect to your data in S3 and other data sources, bring them into a data lake, allows you to set up a data catalog in Glue, and then provide fine-grained access controls, and then enables you to use those access controls to enable self-service access to data. And with Lakeformation, you can really simplify security and access management. It integrates with all of our analytics services so that once you've defined your access policies in one place, they then flow through into all of your other systems. And then you can run analytics and machine learning, and you can set it up for different groups of users, all with access to different views of the data without creating multiple copies. And this is a game changer for enabling self-service. And when it comes to building data lakes, you know, as we talked about, customers want support for updates and deletes. They want fine-grained access control. But you also have to manage your data lake and optimize it. Sometimes you've got lots of small files which are inefficient to query. You want to make these things work faster and more optimally. And that's why I'm excited to announce these capabilities in Lakeformation that remind you of these capabilities that Adam talked about. We've got Govern Tables, which is a table where we can automatically handle ACID transactions. You can add and update data, and other users can query that data, and the system automatically manages conflicts. We've got built-in storage optimization, so because we're handling the metadata, we can automatically compact and optimize storage behind the scenes. That means queries speed up, you scan less data, and you don't ever have to change your apps. This also supports time travel and data versioning. Again, the ability to go back in time and see what happened. If someone makes a mistake, you can unwind. Again, just a ton of capabilities being brought to data lakes in a fully managed serverless environment. And you know, with Lakeformation, you get row-level security, so you can define which users see which tables, columns, rows. You can then enable easy data sharing, and you can even use tags to define groups and columns and rows that people can see or not see, all without making copies of data. And then when it comes to data integration and connecting data, we've got Glue, which is our serverless data integration service. It's really aimed at breaking down data silos, unifying data, enabling you to run automated data pipelines at scale, as well as classic ETL and ELT type workloads. Glue is aimed at multiple personas, so you can have developers and data engineers as well as non-experts working with data. And it's designed to be completely serverless and offers a very high-performance Spark execution environment optimized at discovering schema and running ETL and data transformation workloads. Again, ton of innovation in Glue to provide a scalable and serverless execution engine to save you money and to speed up jobs. We've got unified data governance. It's integrated with Lakeformation. We can auto-discover schema, so you don't have to define data sets. It can go and look and infer what data structure you have and then make that available for querying in Athena or Redshift or EMR. We've got the ability to connect and ingest to multiple data sources wherever data lives, in databases, data lakes, on-premise, and the ability to have that be brought in and transformed and made available for analytics. All using standard analytic environments. There's also a rich connector ecosystem and the ability to write your own connectors. And then we're finally focused on really being productive interfaces for a wide variety of users. And so as an example, some of these interfaces are Glue Studio, we're aimed at ETL developers, classic boxes and arrows for building ETL workflows and pipelines. We've got Glue Data Brew, which is a low-code environment for data cleansing and data prep and data profiling. And so you can work with ML-assisted data preparation, and you don't have to be an expert. And then we've got notebooks for data engineers that want to work with Python, and they can work directly in a familiar notebook environment, all powered by that scalable ETL engine underneath it. And so it's really about breaking down silos, about connecting data, and this is about replication, about moving data to and from. It's also about integrated federated queries. So with a federated query, you can actually combine data in operational stores and data lakes and data warehouses from a single place. And Athena and Redshift allow you to do this transparently, and we've got customers that are using these to really powerful effect to connect multiple disparate data sources from a single interface. And this is, again, about unification. We've also integrated ML pervasively throughout. And so here, it's really about bringing machine learning into your data, into databases, and into warehouses and lakes, and into BI. And so we've got Aurora and Neptune ML, Redshift and Athena have ML built in, let you create models, run inference without ever leaving your environment. And QuickSight also has machine learning built in to help you make sense of all of your data. And so when it comes to Redshift ML, you can write a create model SQL statement. We actually call out to SageMaker automatically train a model, compile it, bring it back into the warehouse, and then you can run inference at massively parallel scale. Again, multiple customers using this, Magellan Rx in pharmaceuticals, JobCase for matching job seekers with job applications. And then with Athena ML, a similar model, never have to leave the Athena environment, and you can connect to machine learning. And then with QuickSight, you can get multiple types of machine learning insights, as well as natural language querying capability, which is incredibly powerful. And so what you have is the ability to automatically generate narratives about what happened in your data. You can get predictive dashboards. QuickSight Q, we'll talk about in a second. You can detect anomalies, and we have built-in forecasting. So it's all about using ML to help you figure out what's interesting in your data, rather than having to you going around spelunking, trying to understand what's significant. And so with QuickSight Q, what you get is the ability to ask natural language questions. You know, tell me about the best-selling products. How does that compare to last year? You don't need to use clunky keywords, and you can do all this without having to do a lot of complicated data modeling. It's a really powerful way to have Q operate on all of the services that we talked about across your data lakes and analytics services to get value. And you know, we've got a huge and growing number of customers using QuickSight. I think they really love the ability to have machine learning built in, but also the ability to have QuickSight's serverless embedded visualization capabilities in their applications. And so now I'd like to invite Niraja, who's a principal product manager on Redshift, to give you a quick demo of Redshift and QuickSight.
Thank you, Rahul. At AWS, we are rapidly innovating to make analytics easy and accessible for all users in the organization. Today, we are very excited to talk to you about Amazon Redshift Serverless and Amazon QuickSight, which makes analytics even easier. Let's get started. In the video game industry, it's hard to know which game will be a hit and which will be a flop. Let's say I work at a gaming company and we just launched a new game that becomes a surprise success due to a stellar review from a Twitch influencer. Now, the good news, we have millions of users across the world using our game. This increase in players is generating petabytes of events data that we need to aggregate and analyze across our sales, advertising, game development, and other teams. For diverse use cases, such as reporting on the business KPIs, monitoring the real-time performance of the game, and informing our game personalization and monetization efforts. Let's see how we can easily load, query, and analyze this data using Redshift Serverless and QuickSight Q. Previously, when we wanted to analyze this kind of data using our on-premises data warehouse, we had to rely on our technical teams to set up, configure, and tune the data warehouse. This could take many days or even weeks. Now, with the new serverless option in Amazon Redshift, we don't have to think about capacity or wait for IT. Redshift Serverless automatically provisions the data warehouse resources and scales them intelligently to deliver high performance for our workloads. We just need to focus on getting our business insights fast. In just a few clicks from AWS Management Console, I can get started with querying in Redshift, and I don't need to choose the node types, specify node count, or do any other manual configuration. The game data is being streamed and aggregated in real time to load into Redshift, along with a variety of structured and semi-structured data sources, such as player log files and external game operations data. Getting the data that I need into Redshift is very easy. In Redshift, I can also directly query the game telemetry data from my data lake in Amazon S3, and also query the player engagement data in real time from my operational database in Amazon Aurora. If we want to collaborate with other teams for cross-group analytics or to align on development strategies, we can do that easily and securely without any data movement. Thanks to Redshift's comprehensive data sharing capabilities within and across accounts and across AWS regions. The query activity from our developers, analysts, and data scientists has increased significantly since the launch of the game. And the diversity of these use cases is generating varying and unpredictable workloads on our data warehouse. Redshift serverless seamlessly and automatically scales in seconds to handle this growth in data and the query workload while still delivering consistently fast performance. Redshift serverless also helps us optimizing costs as our needs change by matching the capacity to our workload demands. We no longer have to pay for idle durations. With my data sources configured, now I want to use QuickSight Q to analyze the player behavior and see if there are opportunities to increase the revenue. Q enables anyone in the organization to ask questions in natural language and get answers with relevant visualizations. We no longer have to rely on our BI teams to update the dashboards for every new question that we might want to ask. We just launched a game update, and we want to see which features are performing the best. Our most popular feature is our newest, Achievement Awards. But let's see if this is translating into revenue. Notice how Q provides suggestions for phrases with autocomplete so that we can quickly and easily ask questions without having to remember the exact terms. I can even expand on this question to see this information based on geography. Notice how Q provides visualizations dynamically based on the type of data set. Overall, this is good news. This new feature is generating a lot of player interest and also creating revenue across the world. So based on this analysis, I will make a recommendation that we do some A/B testing and try to increase the revenue and the engagement by making this feature as part of our other games as well. Q also makes getting and sharing insights with my company as well as my rest of my organization very, very easy. I can also see the top questions from other users so that I can get ideas to improve my own dashboards. With the new easy-to-use serverless option in Amazon Redshift, combined with the machine learning-powered visualizations in QuickSight Q, we were able to load petabytes of data, perform queries, and uncover insights for everyone in the organization. With the seamless and automatic scaling capabilities, to meet our workload demands and just paying for what we use. Thank you.
Thank you, Niraja. That was awesome. I'm really excited to see what customers end up doing with this. And you know, just to recap everybody, thank you. Really, we're trying to help our customers modernize their data infrastructure, take advantage of the best of breed capabilities that we offer and all of the innovation you've seen today. We want to help customers unify their data silos, build data lakes, get the best of data lakes and purpose-built systems, and then build a solid and well-governed foundation to enable data sharing and self-service. And all of this unlocks customers and sets them all free to innovate and take advantage of everything that we offer in machine learning to develop new customer experiences and create new efficiencies. And so with that, thank you very much. And a big thank you to all the teams that worked hard on all of these products to bring them to all of you. It's great to have you all here. Enjoy the rest of reInvent. Thank you.